Hi, Bill Caskey back at Whiteboard Wednesday. This is our first voyage in 2011, the new year, and we're excited about some of the content that we have coming up on Whiteboard Wednesday, not just today, but also in future episodes. If you're watching this prior to January the 28th, which is a Friday, you might still have time to get registered for the Advanced Selling Podcast Live studio recording of the Advanced Selling Podcast that Brian Neal and I do. It's at the Jazz Kitchen, 54th and College. We're going to do a little music, a little lunch, a little learning, a little podcasting, and I think you'll enjoy it. So we're limiting the seating to about 75, so hopefully there's still room when you get there, but go to advancedsellingpodcast.com/live. Also, we're going to be talking in the 2B segment today, Brooke Green and I, about part of the sales cycle. You know, we get a lot of calls and emails from listeners to the podcast and viewers of Whiteboard Wednesday. And there's a constant struggle with, how do I manage the sales cycle better? How do I keep things moving in it? How do I distinguish myself from other people who might be calling on the same prospect? And so Brooke and I give you a couple other things to think about, to look at today, and to explore, and I think it might help you. Then I'm going to come back at the end and take a question from our mailbag segment. First, Brooke Green and myself doing 2Bs. We want to spend a little time talking about the sales cycle, and I had a situation here a few weeks ago where I was called on by some folks trying to sell me professional service, and Brooke and I were talking today about that experience, and we wanted to do a little piece on it because I think this is something that probably affects all of us in professional selling, especially if you're selling something that is in any way intangible. Now, it could be even a building or an actual product, but there's an intangible function to it. There's something about it that's intangible. It could be your knowledge. It could be the process you take your prospects through. So we want to talk about that a little bit today. Mm-hmm. You know, our process, and we've talked about this on Whiteboard Wednesday and the podcast, our process is you need to go in as a professional salesperson today and find out what the problem is, find out what the pain is, what the issues are, what the frustrations are. And I think that, you know, you don't have to be in sales very long to learn how to do that. That really is a series of questions, and you have to get your mind right around how you ask it, but it's pretty simple. The challenge is, how are you going to demonstrate your competence? So if I'm getting ready to hire you, you come in and talk to me about my problems, that's not enough. Because everybody comes in and talks to me about my problems. Every salesperson I might see on this topic kind of has the same approach. Let's find out what your needs are, what your problems are. Now, if you're not even doing that, then you're not even in the game of selling. But presumably you're doing that. But how do you demonstrate competence? And how, if you are not demonstrating competence, how do you discover that I, the prospect, am not okay and am agitated? And we've come up with a couple of ideas that we think are good to help you so that we give you something in the next couple of minutes that can help you go through the process a little bit more, maybe a little bit more functionally with your prospects. Okay. So you want to do part number one, point
sure.
number one?
Okay, and good. Before I do that, I want to give it a little bit of cushion. Part of, you know, the whole finding pain process, I think something that happens is, I'd like to think that all of us go in with the intent to make it about our prospect, and that's where the questions come from, and we're trying to find their pain. But then the minute, not the minute, but sometime around that when we find it, our intent or our agenda moves from finding it to, okay, now I have to be all about me so that they trust that I'm the best solution for fixing that pain. And it's almost like we lose respect for the pain that they've given us. So one of the other things we teach in our sales process besides finding pain is the idea of a statement of intent in the beginning of the meeting. Bill, thanks for inviting me in today. Here's what I was hoping to do. At the end of this meeting, we can decide if we talk again, blah, 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 right? We were talking today that we thought it would be a great idea to, you know, have a statement of intent at halftime. You know, kind of call a timeout, maybe if you have an hour planned, a half hour in, and say, you know what, Bill, here's what we were planning on talking about today. Here's where the conversation's gone. Do you still feel like we're on the right path? Am I answering the questions? Do you feel like you have enough information? If not, let's talk about it now before we get too much farther into the meeting. And just doing a check-in, I think all of us assume through the whole thing that everybody's okay. And obviously in your, you know, meeting and in mine, the person wasn't okay at all.
So your point is, how would a prospect ever be able to give voice to what they want or what they're not getting without asking? Because they're probably not going to say, stop, I'm not feeling good about this right now. I feel like I'm a little bit agitated. They're not going to be that.
Unless they're an incredibly evolved human
being. Yeah, exactly. So
I don't know any of those.
So maybe, not around here at least. So maybe what you're saying is do a check-in at halftime or somewhere during the sales process, mm-hmm. and especially if you notice that they are agitated. Mm-hmm. Maybe they start looking at their watch, as I did a couple of weeks ago. Maybe there's some visual clue that they give off that causes you to say, uh-oh, something's not right here. I better check in.
Right.
I really like that.
Right. I think, too, you know, the whole idea of the statement of intent in the beginning of the sales call is to keep everybody okay, to allow them to tell you the truth. So what a perfect tool to use in the middle of the sales meeting. And I also think it's a good check-in for you, because it's a good time to ask yourself too, okay, am I still thinking about them, or have I moved on to how I'm going to spend my commission check?
Yeah.
Once I make this deal. So you really need to keep yourself in check as well.
Yeah, and we talk a lot about the idea of being detached and the idea of having high intent. As a reminder, high intent is when you make it all about your prospect, and it's really not about you. But yet I think sometimes there's that threshold in the sales cycle that we pass, or in the sales call that we pass, where we say, okay, enough about you, let's talk about me now and how I'm going to solve your problem and get paid for it. Mm-hmm. So be careful when you walk up to that line of intent. If you stray and go the opposite way, it becomes really hard to get back, because then when you try to get back on the prospect's intent, it sounds a little bit too contrived and phony. So walk up to the line. If you feel yourself getting ready to go over it, then stop and ask yourself, am I positioning my product and my value and me through the customer's eyes or through my eyes?
Right.
You know, I do an online course every couple of nights where a fellow sends me some videos, and he was talking about affiliate marketing the other night, marketing. And he said it's amazing to him. He gets 100 pitches a week from people who want him to promote their product. And he says 99 out of 100 of those never ever talk about the pitch from his perspective. They always talk about it from their perspective. Hey, would you help me? I'm looking to get to this amount of money. I'm looking to promote this, blah, blah, blah. And it shouldn't be about the person. So you're really in a sales process there. You're selling me on using my list to promote your products. Don't come to me telling me what you want. Come to me helping me understand that this is a good deal for me.
Right.
And it's the same with prospects too.
Exactly.
So the third thing is, and I don't know if these are in any order, obviously not, because third seems to be like it should be first, but is if you've had a call recently, and maybe you're watching this and have just gotten back from a call, or maybe there was a call that you had important the last couple of days, go back and do a review of that call after you've left and say, did anything happen during that interaction where I maybe got ahead of myself, or maybe I lost my way, I lost my intent? Did anything happen? Did I notice anything as I look back where the prospect lost interest? Usually if they fall asleep, that's a good indicator.
That's a definite loss of momentum there.
That's right. Jeff Foxworthy should do a whole show on terrible when they fall asleep, look at their watch, stop answering your questions, stop asking questions. If it's a good dialogue, shouldn't they be asking as many questions as you are? And the answer is yes, and many times it's not the case.
Right. I think, too, it's important, you said something in the beginning of, you know, this last bit of information was, you know, give it some space. We were doing the analogy with football, you know, like the Colts just lost a pretty painful game. And, you know, they give it a couple days. They watch film and they autopsy what they did, but they give it some space, because if you try to do it while you're still sitting there and it's too late, it's just annoying and frustrating.
Try to do it, meaning try to bring up this issue or try to fix the
right, or remedy it or whatever it is. We were talking about both of our situations, and had the person that lost us in the process tried to do it before they left, it probably would have killed the deal completely. But had they given it some space, a day or two, and come back and say, you know what, Bill, during that meeting, I felt like there was a point where we got off track. Mm-hmm. I wasn't feeling like you were, you know, as interested as you had been in the beginning. So if it's still okay and you're still interested, can we talk about that?
Yeah, it's good.
And go back.
Better to
and
do it after the fact.
Right.
Yeah.
Give so it some space.
I hope that was helpful. We don't want to make a big deal out of something that's not a big deal, but we had these things happen, and we've seen it many times before where we're the buyer. We want to buy really bad, but the seller doesn't allow us to buy. And they don't allow us to buy because they don't keep us psychologically whole and okay during the sales process. So just check it out for yourself. Go back and look at some last calls in the last few days. And if you're in a process in the next few weeks, just make sure that you're doing all you can to keep the intent on the prospect, not on you.
Yeah.
Okay. I enjoyed two B's. This is
Thank
a two B, two A B, two B A. We'll do it again sometime. I know that many of you face this, whether it's because you're in markets where commodity prices are starting to increase, you know, oil is starting to go up, gold, all the commodities are going up, so it could influence your price, your pricing scheme a little bit. But how do you do it? Because there's always this angst about price increases. And though I thought I'd throw out a couple of ideas here if you're getting ready to raise prices to your clients. First thing is 80-20 rule. What the 80-20 rule to me says is sometimes I think we tend to treat all customers alike. And in his case, he said his company was getting ready to send out an email or a letter to all clients saying, this is the price increase. Well, I don't think that's right. I think you should take the 20% of your clients that probably represents the highest amount of revenue and go make it, pay a visit to them, or at least a phone call. I like visits. I think you can sit down eye to eye with someone, and the context and the vibe is totally different than if it hits somebody in an email box or even a letter. So I would say think 80-20. Take the 20% of your people, which if you're an average account rep, you might have 50 accounts. Take those 10 people, go see them. And when you go see them, don't be defensive, which we'll get into a little bit later. Don't send an email out to everybody, especially if it's a significant price increase, especially if they're not used to seeing something from you. Second thing is elastic. Now, what I mean by elastic is really what I'm talking about there is the rule of economics. And the rule of economics is price elasticity. And price elasticity simply says that price and consumption is elastic to the price, meaning when we raise the price, consumption goes down. You've got to think of your product in different terms. And so the opposite of that is inelastic. It means price has no bearing on the value. And I think what this means to me is you've got to make sure you keep the value in front of the buyer or your consumer as you're talking about the price increase. Not from a place of here's how good we are, therefore the price increase is little. It's just here's a reminder. Here's some things that we have helped you do. Here's some things that we will be allowed to do with the price increase. Make sure the value stays in front of them so that price becomes inelastic. It doesn't matter what the price is, the consumption stays the same. And the third thing that we talk about is personal. Personal means if you have a little discomfort with price increases, if you are uncomfortable in any way with how it was communicated or the fact that you have to communicate it, be honest with the prospect. I find that the more honest you are, and even if you're to the point of saying, look, the last thing I want to do is pass on a price increase. That's not what I get paid for. I don't enjoy it. You don't enjoy getting them. I don't enjoy giving them. Trust me. But in this case, it's something that we have to do. Let me tell you why. Add a personal flavor to that. Add a personal note. Let them know that you're a real human being and not just someone who's taking a price increase from the company and passing it through. Give a personal flair to it. Acknowledge the difficulty. Even to the point, I've got some clients who acknowledge that, look, you may choose not to accept this and to go somewhere else. And while I would never want that to happen, I realize that's part of doing business. You have to weigh, Mr. Prospect, the price that I'm charging with the value that you're getting. And if at any point the price is higher than the value, then you should look to move. Hopefully, we've been able to communicate to you and through your experience with us that the value is still higher than the price, but that's a decision you'll have to make. In other words, give them an out. Now, I know your sales managers, VPs, are going to hate that because it's going to sound wimpy, but come on, they do have other options. And I think by bringing it up then, you have a better chance at offsetting that with the value discussion than if you just go away hoping they're going to take it and then they email you back in 2 weeks and say, you know what, we're not going to take it. We're going to stay where we are. So hope those help. 80-20 rule means make sure you treat your top 20% differently. Go see them. Inelastic value means you've got to make sure that price is not the factor that value is. And personal, acknowledge the personal part of price increases. So I hope that helps our friend in Australia, and I hope it helps you if you have any kind of situations in the upcoming period of time where you have to do something. And it doesn't have to be raising prices. It could be something else that's uncomfortable. It could be cutting out a certain product segment. It could be reducing the size of something. Anything that might be uncomfortable, you can still use this. Hope that helps. See you next time on Whiteboard Wednesday.